Trembles at his voice. the chain will break. His broken hearts declare his praise. But who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb.
Church, go ahead and stand as we worship. we welcome you here this morning, church. How's everybody doing with the cold this morning? Everybody likes it? And the people that come from the cold, they're all thumbs up, and the people who are here are like thumbs down. So it's kind of mixed reactions here. Well, we're glad that you're here with us today. This morning, let's warm this place up.
Good, a firm foundation, a rock, the only solid ground. As nations rise and fall, our domes once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus.
You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are
in love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus.
Come on, lift it up, we trust the name.
We trust the name of Jesus.
are not alone. If you are lonely, when you feel afraid, you're not the only. We're all the same, in need of mercy, to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need, yeah.
And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for His love never ends. And all the people said amen.
If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. He so loved the world, He sent His Son to save us all.
And all the people said amen. Whoa. People said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for His love never ends.
Yeah.
And all the people said amen.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another star. Time, turn to your neighbor, tell them you're glad to see them today, give them a shake of a hand or hug.
Thank you. Good morning. If you guys could all start heading back to your seats so we can get started in our next section. I'm going to lead the next song, but before I do, I want to say thank you to you guys. It is amazing when everybody sings and we're all singing praises together. And I don't know that you noticed this, but we all have these earphones in and we're listening to clicks to stay together and all the different things, and it is cranking loud, and I could still hear you guys singing. It was awesome. And so, yes, thank you. So at some time, I think, you know, you guys all appreciate us, but I want you to know that we appreciate you too, because
Absolutely.
It's so amazingly encouraging. I mean, we spend a lot of hours practicing and it's so wonderful to see that it actually means something. And it's so encouraging with fellow Christians that I can tell that you guys love God and that we're all coming together. And it's just exciting. So I wanted to give you our perspective. You guys, it's just neat. So anyway, the next song, switching gears, is Come Alive, Dry Bones. And when we were rehearsing it this morning, this song has been in my mind all week long. Some life situations with friends that are going on, and I think that God works this way, and we're actually going to find out. I didn't know, but the sermon is actually about being rooted in faith and things like that. So God works that way, bringing similar things to people in his congregation together. So this song, I want to read to you the verse, or the chorus, excuse me. We call out to dry bones to come alive. We call out to dead hearts to come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones to come alive. And as I was rehearsing this morning, I felt like God was encouraging me to share with you. The imagery that came into my head was the Australian wildfires that are happening right now. And I'm a middle school teacher, and the kids are, they don't understand the world, right? And so they're really impacted by it, and the images are devastating to them. And one of the things that I encourage them with is that, yes, it looks desolate and it looks like everything is done, but everything that nature needs to replenish itself is still there, right? All of the seeds are still there. It just needs the proper conditions to flourish and to grow again. And that goes along with our spiritual lives too, right? And so I think sometimes we are in really dry periods. And honestly, I will be completely honest, I'm a really emotional person, and I spend a lot more time in the dry season, I think, than I do in a flourishing season. And I'm learning to not be afraid of that, because it doesn't mean that I'm dead. It just means that things are a little more buried at the moment, right? And I am learning in this season that you have to consistently water your faith and soak in God's promises and his word. And this last year, I made the goal to read through the whole Bible. I've made it 75% through. But yeah, and it's made a difference. But I will tell you, I don't have like this amazing growth experience every time I sit down and read the Bible. It's a discipline, right? But I have found that as I'm going through life and things come up and I'm like, why is, what? You know, I don't have an answer for it. I find God brings scripture to mind, or he brings the story of David and Bathsheba to mind. And, you know, so if we soak ourselves in God's promises and we water ourselves daily, even if we don't see that it's making a difference, those things are growing underneath, and eventually they're going to produce fruit, right? And so I guess that's my encouragement to you today, and to not fear the dry seasons, because it doesn't mean that God doesn't love you, and it doesn't mean that you're not growing. And sometimes nature needs things to be pruned back in order for it to continue moving forward. And so that's just my encouragement. And also water yourself with people who are godly and sermons. There's a lot of different apps out there and different radio programs. Just keep watering it, because it will grow. So while I'm singing this song, if you guys could just kind of imagine God pouring water into your life and all the things that we need to have to grow. Oops, hold on, I'm sorry. We have lost as we
that you are God, yours is the victory. We know there is more to come that we may not yet see. So with the faith you've given us, we step into the valley unafraid. We call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive.
Savior is more than a story to me. He laid his life down on that cross. What a sight to see. He shook the earth with just his last breath. Now the demons believe. Let me tell you about a Savior. He's more than a story for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He's more than a mystery. My sins tears and my sorrows. He rocked the grave and set me free. He came to earth to be my rescue, God and man to take my shame. Jesus comes and he takes your sins away. You might say it's hard to believe our Father sent his Son for me. I say, amazing grace, how sweet sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I found what's mine. Savior is more than a story to me. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus,
as first love.
Father, we're so thankful. We've sang through these songs about restoration, Lord Father, the fact that you have planted the seed in us, Lord Father, and there's times that we need to be consistent with our prayer in you and our reading our Bible, and Lord Father, and you feeding us and watering us through your Holy Spirit, who gives us the understanding of all Scripture. We give you the glory for that. God, you are amazing. So, Father, we pray today as we love you, and you first loved us, and we love you because of that. We just pray that you would teach us through your word, Lord God, and may it just not hit our ears and just be a seed that's just thrown on rocky or hard ground, Lord Father, but let it take root in our heart. We love you. We thank you. It's in your Son's name we're so privileged to praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Man, give God a hand clap today, can we? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, praise team. Thank you, thank you. A dream, a wish, and a desire that I hold on to is the very next house, hopefully, I'll be able to purchase, that a section of that property, man, I've got some plans for it. I'm thinking I would like to put a little small garden with some vegetables and some flowers in here. Garden freaks, you guys like garden? How many like to eat out of a garden? Yes? Yes? Okay. All right, good. Also, I'd like to have a little small part of the land devoted to some, like a little mini orchard, if you will, with some fruits that I can enjoy, just to, you know, be part of that whole experience there. I mean, I'm nothing huge, nothing huge. I'm talking enough to, you know, to give a little bit of sustenance for life and but most about the beauty to enjoy it, and most about just being able to give God the glory for how he makes things grow. Now, the extent, however, of my growing ability, okay, it's not very extensive, but potatoes seem to be what I can grow. So you're looking at the second grade winner of the best potato plant. You know what I'm talking about, right? The jar, the toothpicks, the potato, you know what I'm talking about. Yeah, you're looking at this guy right here, second grade winner. That's what I did. And then and then later in life, I actually grew some potatoes, you know, from those little seedlings, if you will, cut little pieces and shove it in the dirt. And that was cool. Came out real big and beautiful. Big, healthy plants in a pot. Of course, not very huge potatoes growing when they're harvested. But I will say I like eating me some potatoes. That's what I do like. I do like potatoes a lot. You know, there's one person I've been thinking about, especially in line of that, when that moment presents itself as to who I will seek counsel and wisdom on the best way to ask questions and pick his brain about getting things to grow, and that's going to be my dad. My dad from the children's home for where I was raised. And I'll tell you what, there's something about this guy and what he's done. Anything that he pretty much plants becomes, I mean, beautiful. And he has the most incredible roses that he makes for roses for my mom. And I'm not talking small little roses. I'm talking like big roses. And of course, he, you know, he has a citrus orchard that I wish so bad I had a picture of it to show you today. But just trees just loaded with fruit. Pretty much, again, everything that he plants is amazing. Plants and ivy just exploding, going around, growing all over the house. I mean, he just has that kind of way. And it always grows vibrantly. It always grows healthy. And, of course, tree-producing and then, of course, beautiful. What is his secret? Well, his secret, he told me, is that he fertilizes twice a year and that he soaks for 6 hours every 3 months, all the trees and what have you. And when planted, what he does, and I've seen him, he'll go and he'll grab the backhoe and dig, I mean, a man-sized hole with that backhoe and go down super deep and add all fresh dirt and fertilized dirt and just, I mean, just big, deep hole so that no matter what he plants in it, it takes, it has deep roots, and it just grows well. The result, obviously, what he does in that fertile ground is that it's able to receive the seed, able to receive the plant that is planted in it. And it's free from that hardened clay. You know what I'm talking about, right? Anybody here have the joy of digging something here in our dirt? Yeah? Isn't caliche wonderful? Caliche is a blast, isn't it? True story. I used to show 4-H. I did that all through my high school years. I did the circuit of the state fair, national fair, went down Tucson, I mean, county fair, you name it, I've done it. And one of the things we did is we showed beef cattle, okay, so I had to show steers, the kind of meat you eat when you go to get a package of meat. And so we're going through the whole deal, and because Arizona's so doggone hot, we dug what we called a cool room, okay, which was, it was about 10 feet deep, 20 wide, 40 long, and had a roof about 8.5, 9 feet. And what we did is we put air conditioners and we put evaporative coolers on this thing. And so we had to dig in Arizona ground. And does anybody know what a caterpillar is? Big earth mover, you know what I'm talking? It looks like a tank on tracks and the whole deal. Yeah, we broke a 7-ton cat trying to dig that caliche. So caliche, that hard clay, oh yeah, it's hard. But you know what? This didn't have it. He got rid of it all. There was no hardness whatsoever. It was free from rocks and it was free from weeds. And that's why everything grew so amazingly whenever he would plant it. So when that ground is prepared in this way, what happens, the result, the natural result, is that roots are able to go deep. And they're to be unobstructed. And big, healthy plants and trees become the result. And all of those, again, they produce a crop, a harvest, with such beauty as God intended as they were created to become. And that's what makes it so much fun. And, you know, it's so cool because how many times do we see in Scripture that God will use some sort of form of agricultural talk to be able to make a heavenly principle known? And I love that because we can learn so many spiritual lessons from the garden or the orchard as they visually teach us about heavenly principles. There's many examples that Jesus did. In fact, we see this all throughout, especially the Gospels, in his teachings. He used all kinds of common experiences that all of them had or had experienced in some way so that it just made it easier to convey the truth. And he used a lot of farming and a lot of ranching. That's what we see, you know, throughout those pages. So one such teaching that Christ used was farming through seeds. Seeds that were thrown among four kinds of soil. And we're going to look at that a little bit today. In fact, grab your fill in the blank here. I'm going to give you the first one here today. Is that during Christ's 3.5-year time of ministry. Now, he was on the earth for 33.5 years. But keep in mind that he only actually spoke and taught and what have you from the beginning of his ministry to the cross. And the resurrection was about 3.5 years. So during that 3.5-year time of ministry, he was so radically different from anyone else that was teaching in his time. In fact, I'm going to give you the first three fill in the blank here. He taught with authority. He taught also with passion. And he also taught with confrontation. You know, people said, oh my goodness, he speaks with such authority. How can he do this? Why? Because they were so used to the religious that were there and were present. And yet the truth that he would convey, they just knew that it had substance and bite to it. And not only the authority, but he did it with such passion. And it was out of love that it was motivation most of the time of most of his messages. And yet, at times, it was also confrontational because why? He wanted to knock people off center so that they might consider a vertical relationship with God Almighty. And so he would take that time and say the words in such an incredible way that would just get you to think about it, get you to kind of soak on it a little bit. And then there were times where he just straight up just squared you up, you know, became a New Yorker and boom, hit you right with it. You know what I mean? And just didn't mince words. But we see that all throughout. Why? Why would he do that? Is your next fill in the blank here? Is because this was important, because eternity is a forever thing. Eternity is a forever thing. Keep this in mind. See, we're not people who simply are here for a short period of time and then we die and then we go to dust and we're done. There is a part of us that when we physically die, our spirit and soul will continue on. And it's a destination of where that's going to be that we're going to spend forever. And God, through Christ, and he knew and understood how valuable this understanding is. And he didn't want anyone to miss it. He didn't want anybody to overlook it. He didn't want anybody to just not think about it. I mean, let's be honest. How much do you really think about eternity? Do you really think about it? None of you think about it. That's awesome. Okay. Oh, a few of you do. Okay. Everybody's like, huh? No. I mean, are you talking to me? I don't know. You know. Here's the deal. I think there's times that I do. You know what I'm saying? Like, I kind of think, man, what's heaven going to be like? It's going to be cool, right? Scripture describes it as all these cool stones and gems and colors and things. So even that's kind of hard to really kind of put your hands around, right? But it's in thinking about that, it's like, oh, yeah, I do from time to time. But if I'm really honest, I probably don't think about eternity that much. You know, I don't know. Maybe as the older I get, maybe that'll become more important. Maybe it's thinking, well, God, did I live a good life? And, you know, is my life almost finished kind of thing? Maybe that might jog some things. I don't know. But I know I don't think about it a whole lot. But I tell you, it was first and foremost and present on the mind of Christ. Why? Because as he spoke to people, he wasn't looking at someone who's a mere mortal. He looked at someone who was forever. They were going to be forever, and it was so important to him and so passionate to him that he wants everyone to be able to have that eternity that's not going to exist in a place of suffering and torment, but a place in which you can have the most incredible relationship with Almighty God. And so it mattered. And it mattered to him when he would teach. Eternity is a forever thing. Fill in the rest of the fill in the blank here. And mankind desperately needs to have and to make peace with God through his way, that is through Jesus and what he did on the cross in the finished work of Jesus, which, by the way, we're going to be celebrating here the resurrection towards April. Thinking about that, it's the finished work of Christ, of the cross with Christ, that is his way that we make peace. And it's not through man's way, which is just understanding. Can't tell you how many times I've talked to people, and they say, well, you know, what do you do with God? Well, God and I, yeah, we got an understanding. Have you ever heard that before? Yeah, we got an understanding. He does him, I do me, we're good, right? We got an understanding, right? I've really heard that. No, I'm not joking. Seriously. It's not about that. It's not going to God on our own terms. It's about going to God on his terms. And his terms is through the cross of Christ and what he's about. So as crowds would grow around him, he would take those opportunities. I love it. Jesus was such a master teacher. I mean, he cheats because he wrote the book. He knows how to just get the word across in a perfect way, right? And be able to convey that truth and get you to think about it. And kind of knock you off center and knock you out of your comfort zone and just get you to be thinking about, hey, what's most important? And so as those crowds would gather around him, he would take those opportunities to influence the hearts and the minds, softening them towards and turning them, others of them, to God to be the source of forgiveness and healing and life and peace and joy and comfort and guidance. That God would be the one. That God would be the one that we would think to say, God, I need you in each of those areas. I can't do this on my own strength. I can't do it in my own intellect and understanding. But I can only do it in you. And he was trying to push others to seeing God as that source. And the beauty is, as hearts and minds, as they turn away from the world and as they turn to God, that in essence is the picture of repentance. That's what it's about, turning away from the things of the world and sin, and it's turning to the things of God and allowing him to be that focus, that repentance comes in. Well, what happens is when you do that, then the right heart starts to be developed in you, because you're not chasing the things of the world anymore. You're not going to them as the source of your strength and your hope and your peace and your joy and your forgiveness, which, by the way, is very temporary. But when you go to God and you go to him for strength and peace and joy and forgiveness and hope and all of these wonderful things, it's forever. And it sits with you, and that heart becomes right. Right within you. Right, a right kind of heart that allows things to be rooted deep. The things of God in that relationship and connection with Jesus Christ, which brings us to our series. That's what we're talking about, being rooted deep, how that's so valuable, and how that's going to play and flesh out in each of our lives today. So if you look at your bulletin here, or your little thing that I gave you, the handout, I've given you the big idea of today. Today's message is this: the gospel message itself is the power of God unto salvation for all who believe. Can I get an amen to that? Because that is what it is. Do you realize the message of Christ, what he's done, who he is, who we are in him, those three foundational questions is solved in him. And so it is that power, that message, that hope, okay, that is the power of God unto salvation for all who believe. And in order for that power of God to be realized within the individual hearer, it must first have a place that it can be received and can be rooted. And what we're talking about is the place is your heart, the peace within you. Now, it's that place that is in you. Now, Scripture does teach us something, doesn't it, concerning the heart of man, okay, and its condition outside of God's influence. How many of you are familiar with Jeremiah 17:9? Two. Great. Let's turn there. Okay. I want you to see this. Go to Jeremiah 17:9, and I want you to see this for yourself. Okay. Jeremiah 17:9. Old Testament. Page 1233 in my Bible. I don't know about you, but Jeremiah 17:9. I want you to hear this. And again, this is the heart that is the heart of man and its condition outside of the influence of God. Okay, and I'll make that clear distinction here. But I want you to see Jeremiah 17:9. I'm going to read to you out of the New Living Translation. This is what it says. It says, "The human heart is the most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is?" Think about that. So what is this saying? Is this saying that our heart within us right now, in our chest, is just evil and diabolical? Is that what it's saying? All of you should be saying no. That's not what it's saying. No, that's not what it's saying. It's not saying our heart is evil. It's the understanding figuratively that the heart is the hub of all of who we are and our personality, our emotions, our feelings, our minds. It's all made up through the way that we feel. And it comes through our heart. Our heart is really kind of seen as the hub or the center. And I'm going to explain that a little bit more here in detail. But what we're saying is that the human heart, that is the sinful, fleshly heart of hearts that has no godly influence. God's not influencing that at all. Okay? That heart is the most deceitful of all things and desperately, desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? Well, the answer to that question is that God knows completely. I hope no one here actually has the thought that somehow, some way, God has no idea what's going on inside of you. I hope you don't think that, because God is intimately involved in each and every one of us. He knows every single thing about us. There's nothing that we have done, that we are doing now, or will do that he will not see, will not know. You can't hide from him. Jonah tried, didn't go so well, right? Jonah tried to run the opposite way to hide from God. No, didn't happen. It's not going to happen with you. It's not going to happen with me. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing, actually. That means we can't get away with it, right? And the issue is still the issue, which is still the heart. And the truth is, God knows it, God sees it, God understands it. And thank God that he does, because he did something about it. And we're going to see that. GotQuestions.org, I encourage you, go to that website from time to time. Great information there, great resources. I love how they kind of give some insight to this passage, okay? It basically says this. It says, the Bible teaches that the heart is to be the hub of human personality, producing the things that we would ordinarily ascribe to the mind. Okay, so it's talking about that, the centrality of the heart, okay? Like, for example, grief and desires and joy and understanding and thoughts and reasoning and, most importantly, faith and belief are all products of the heart. Okay, of course, they give all the scripture for it. And Jesus also tells us that the heart is a repository for good and evil, and that which comes out of the mouth, either good or bad, begins where? Begins in the heart. I hate that proverb. I hate that statement. Why? Because how many times I can't tell you that it says, for out of the mouth, the heart speaks, right? Oh, my goodness. I can't tell you. How many times, anybody here relate with me, said some really stupid things, yeah? I mean, it's like you watch it leave like a flock of doves, right? Just kind of floats out. And then it's like then God's word, bap, hits you in the back of the head going, eh, what'd you do? I don't know if you get that experience. I do from time to time. Don't like it. Not enjoyable, right? But sometimes I don't like the way that my heart looks. Sometimes I don't like the things that I allow for my heart to be influenced by. And God says, hey, you know, if you belong to me, then I'm going to take care of your heart. I'm glad that he does that work in me as he does that work in you. But ultimately, what we're saying here is, again, it all comes from that product of the heart. And either good or bad, good or evil, it comes out of the mouth. It begins in the heart. Now, he goes on to say, he says, and he kind of describes this. It says, a hardened heart, what a hardened heart will do is it dulls a person's ability to perceive and to understand. So it kind of blocks that. They just, if their heart's hard, yeah, they don't see any of it, right? And then those that give in to sin, okay, it causes a heart to grow cold. And then, of course, if you allow pride, okay, nobody here struggles with pride at all, right? You have no problems with that? Y'all good? If you allow pride, it will cause your heart to harden because it just takes root. See, Jesus knew full well. He understood this. He knows who we are. He made us. We're made in the image of God. He formed us, Psalm tells us, in our mother's womb. So he knows who we are, okay? He knew full well the war that is for our hearts, for who we are, and desiring for God to be the only thing that's influencing upon it. That's the desire of Jesus. That's the desire that our Savior has for you and for me, is that we would have a heart that's influenced by God. Jesus took the time. He presented when the crowds gathered around him. He wanted to influence their hearts. He wanted to push them towards God and to move them towards everything that's about him and get rid of all the things that aren't. And that's what we see time and time again, especially here. So how did he do it? How did he do it? Well, we're going to look at this, a parable of the sower. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 13. Matthew 13, we're going to look at verses 1 through 9. So if you didn't bring a Bible, should be a Bible underneath you in the chair. Feel free, grab one of those if you would. Turn to Matthew chapter 13, verses 1 through 9. Matthew chapter 13. I'm going to go through, read it, and then we're going to come back and we're going to talk about it, okay? So how did he do this? He spoke with the parable of a sower, okay? Matthew chapter 13, verses 1 through 9. I'm going to read to you the New Living Translation. Beginning in verse 1. It says this. It says, later that same day, Jesus left the house and sat beside the lake. And a large crowd soon gathered around him, so he got into a boat. Now, pause there. Here's the thing. We see this many times all throughout Scripture, especially the gospel accounts. And anytime he taught, man, he amassed all kinds of people around him. Right? People just flocked to hear what he had to say. And so it got so big as he was by that lake that he got into a boat to be able to accommodate more. So he goes on to say, okay, He says, then he sat there and he taught as the people stood on the shore. He told many stories in the form of parables, such as this one. He says, listen, a farmer went out to plant some seeds. Verse 4, as he scattered them across his field, some seeds fell on a footpath and birds came and they ate them. Other seeds fell on shallow soil with underlying rock, and the seeds sprouted very quickly because the soil was shallow. But the plants soon wilted under the hot sun, and since they didn't have deep roots, they died. Other seeds fell among thorns that grew up and choked out the tender plants, and yet still other seeds fell on the fertile soil, and they produced a crop that was 30, 60, and even 100 times as much as had been planted. And then, as Jesus so masterfully would do, anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand. Now, the teaser here. The teaser is that Jesus gave at the end of this teaching, verse 9, he says what? Anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand. Now, doesn't that seem a bit cryptic to you? I'm the only one that thinks that way. Okay, he wasn't using code talk here. This wasn't the deal. It wasn't meant to be cryptic in the sense of confusion, in the sense that you wouldn't have any understanding of what he just said. Okay, but what he did and his intent was to stimulate the listener, to engage them where they're at in their thinking and get them to self-examine and go, what's really going on inside of me? What's really going on with this truth? Is there anything in this that's for me? And really kind of soak on it a little bit, right? Having that kind of experience and to stimulate them to greater truth and to ask ultimately, how did the fertile soil produce more than sown? And ultimately, coming to the realization of myself, thing, God isn't willing that any should perish, but all come into everlasting life. Isn't that beautiful? This is the part where you say, yes, this is beautiful. Yes, it is beautiful. Why? Because that's the heart of God being shown. Do you know how beautiful it is to know that our Heavenly Father loves us so much, loves you and I so much, loves your family, your friends, your neighbors, your co-workers so much that he isn't willing that any of us should perish but come to everlasting life? Why? Because eternity is a forever thing, and it's important. And his heart is such that he wants us all to have eternity with him. And so in this incredible explanation, in terms of this soil, because it's a forever thing and that God isn't willing that any should perish, it's awesome. I mean, he constantly throws humanity a lifeline. He's constantly given us opportunity to come to him. Okay? And to come to God through faith in him, and ultimately to have a heart change in you. So that's your fill in the blank there. He constantly, okay, again, throws humanity a lifeline to come to God through faith in him, and it's a heart change in you. I am so grateful and so thankful that God sent me at age 13 to a children's home, to be out of my family's home, to be put in a place that was filled with strangers, and ultimately was a place that God knew that I needed to hear about him. I wasn't going to hear about him in my own home. God took me out of that place, placed me in a place as a stranger among people that were telling a message of hope and peace and joy to be found in Jesus. And at age 15, I'll never forget, can't tell you the exact day, but I'll tell you the exact spot. I sat in a chapel that was in this children's home, and I had heard 1,000 times the altar call being given, and I never responded. I always thought somebody was, you're talking to somebody else. You're not talking to me. Until one day. And that one day, the offer was given. And I said yes. You realize that I would not be in this moment with you right here, right now, in this place, had that moment not taken place. That's crazy, right? Because I have crazy fun with you guys because you're crazy. And it's good times. But I look at that and I go, wow, God, how good you are. How good you are that you've thrown that lifeline. My lifeline was put me in that home. I don't know what God's done for you. I don't know what God's doing in you. I will tell you this thing. This is for sure that you hear right now. You're hearing a message that God wants you to hear. Right here, right now. There's nothing accidental or random in this moment. You got to look at things like that. God doesn't do accidents. He does intention. And I love that when God does, because that's how I choose to see it. Again, he gives us that lifeline. Why? Because he wants us to come to him through faith. He wants us to experience a relationship with him, and he wants a change to be done inside of us. Listen to God's appeal to all to come to him. I'm going to read to you a passage out of Joel chapter 2. You want to turn there? Great. If not, just listen. But listen to what God says. He makes this appeal. We're going to see him tip his hand again as to the things that are important to his heart. Joel chapter 2, verses 12 and 13 says this. He says, that is why the Lord says, turn to me now, while there is time. Give me your hearts. Come with fasting and weeping and mourning. Don't tear your clothing in your grief, but tear your hearts instead. Return to the Lord your God, for he is merciful and compassionate and slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love. He is eager to relent and not punish. Does that give you an insight a little bit? Does that show how good God is? How merciful he is, how compassionate he is, how he just wants you and I to give him us what's going on in here. So since this is the heart of God, he says, give me your hearts, come to me, return to the Lord your God. There's four soils that he talks about. I want to go briefly through that today. Four soils that are presented ultimately for us to reflect in and also for us to self-examine. First and foremost is number one. We see this in verse 4. He talks about the footpath. The seeds were sown among the footpath. That is, your version might say the wayside. Okay, or along the side of the road. You might see that, okay? So it's this path that's walked is really what it's being described here. And it's nothing could grow on this ground. Why? Because it is caliche hard, man. Yeah, you try to plant a plant in caliche, yeah, good luck. Yeah, it will not make it, right? And that's what it's saying. It's like it's so caliche hard that it just will not allow. It just, that seed just sits on top and it doesn't go anywhere. And that's why the enemy, the birds, they come in, they snatch that seed right off that hard ground. I mean, there's not even time for it to even think about rooting or growing. And ultimately, seed on this soil, here it is, next fill in the blank here, seed on this soil, it never penetrates. It never will. It's just too doggone hard. And the enemy, the birds, as it's sown quickly, they come and they snatch and eat it up. And though those with this soil, okay, what are they really focused on? Who's he really talking about here? He's saying that those with this soil, they have only one focus, and that focus, that's self. Focused on self above all else. Do you know some people like that? Don't point to anybody next to you, and don't do that. But you know somebody like that? You know what I'm talking about, where it's just them? It's all about them. It's all about their successes and their toys and blah, 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 blah. I mean, like they their priorities are just, it's just about them and their life. I've seen it. I've known it. What I find is, especially what this understanding is, with this soil, it's not only focused on self above all else, but they tend to be dead towards God's spiritual things. They don't care about any of it. They don't even want to hear it. They don't want to be around it. They don't want any kind of influence on it. Nothing. They don't want anything. They don't even want to receive it. In fact, most times they tend to be angry or hostile toward the things of God. You know, the natural mind says it finds God's word very hostile. Doesn't want to have anything to do with it. And the natural mind, we know that is blinded. It's blinded by Satan. Satan just kind of keeps those blinders, keeps you from being able to see the light, see the truth. And ultimately, there's no influence for God due to the hardness of their own heart. So that's the first soil we see. The second one we see is the shallow soil, or the underlying rock, or some of yours might say stony or rocky place. Okay? What it's saying here is that seed on this soil, okay, What it does is it springs up quick and then it dies just as fast. That's your fill in the blank. So it's seed on this soil, it springs up quick and it dies just as fast. Why? Because those with this soil, they tend to have a very shallow depth. There's not a whole lot to them, okay, in terms of their life. In fact, next fill in the blank, they have at times very little influence of anything godly. And this next one is it's also that they have a peaked but not sustained interest. In other words, it kind of just catches them just a little bit. They kind of think about it just a little bit, kind of perks up the curiosity just a little bit. But what the focus tends to be on is this. It's that the best thing, here's your fill in the blank, in the moment is quickly forgotten soon after. It's kind of a momentary thing. They have this just brief little time, brief little experience, and that kind of grabs hold of them. And it's kind of like that warmth of that soil, it springs up quickly, and because it's not deep, there's no roots, it doesn't last. So third soil it talks about is that of the thorns, right? This is the soil that's somewhat fertile. It has a little bit of fertility to it because things are growing in it. But here's the truth of it. It's not well kept. That's your fill in the blank. Okay, it's a soil that's somewhat fertile, but yet not well kept. In other words, weeds are allowed to grow at the same time. And birds, as we use figuratively here, I mean, they can drop whatever they want to drop in there. I'm going to let your mind walk with that one. Right? But they do. They bring about those weeds there. And those with this soil, what do? They let all things influence them, not just God. You know what I'm saying? With the thorns, we're talking about the kind of person that anything is allowed in. And that could be customs and cultures and practices and cares and concerns and distractions. And this next fill in the blank here is it's more about the best thing among other things that I'm looking at until it isn't the best for me anymore. In other words, they kind of say, well, I've got to have a little bit of everything here. I kind of see this almost in line with what I call spiritual buffet. You know what I mean by that? Spiritual buffet, many of you have heard it, some of you haven't. But spiritual buffet, I'll give it to you a real snapshot. First thing I do in a buffet line is what? I survey that whole land. Man, I see what all's offered, right? And then I see what catches my eye. And then what does catch my eye, I take a little bit of this, a little bit of this, a little bit of this, and I make that my plate, right? Well, spiritual buffet is much like that. Spiritual buffet says it takes, especially the soil that has the thorns, what it does, it looks at everything. It says, well, you know what? Christianity is a good thing. Yeah, it's good. Yeah, it's good. And you know what? Oh, I love the love. Love the love. Want lots of love on my plate. Yeah, let's put that on my plate. But you know, also Christianity has about hell, too. Oh, no. Don't want anything to do with hell. No, there's no hell on my plate. No, I don't want no. That's like peas or lima beans or whatever nasty, you know, vegetable you don't like. Right? So no, I don't want hell. No, I don't want hell. But, you know, I want reincarnation. I want this. I want that. And what we do is we kind of grab from all kinds of things. Why? Because the thorn allows all to influence. And this takes a little bit of this, a little bit of this, a little bit of this, puts it on my plate and calls it spiritual. Or spiritual, as some people say. I don't know about you, but when I hear people say that to me, I'm spiritual, it frustrates me inside. Because I'm thinking to myself, okay, wait a second. What are you really saying? What are you really saying? I hear more often when I hear those terms, the things that go off in my mind is that you're more interested to going to God on your own terms versus His. And I'm sad because God wants so much more for you. And it's important that we don't get caught up in the spiritual buffet approach. See, ultimately, God's influence tends to be in this arena that it's in competition with everything else that's unspiritual in the same time, in the same space and place. And those things around me and that gain my attention. So we see those first three soils. So we got the hard, we've got the shallow, we've got, again, the thorny, right? Then he talks about the fourth and final soil, which he talks about in verse 8, which says about the fertile and good soil. And seed on this soil, what does this look like? Well, it's clean. This is a clean soil. Man, this fertile soil, good soil, seed thrown, man, it's clean. It's weed-free. It's well-kept. It's healthy. It's able to receive, able to produce, and able to continue to produce with consistency. Man, I wish I had the picture of my dad's trees. If you saw these things, it'd blow your mind how much fruit is on this. He gets overwhelmed every time he walks out because it's grown so well. And I'm talking trunks, man, on these things that are huge, right? I mean, it's just deep, deep rooted and healthy. And see, that's what the good heart, that's what the fertile heart's all about, because it's open, it's prepped, it's clean, it's ready to receive, ready to produce. And it's consistent in how it produces. And the focus of the fertile soil is this. It's open only to godly influence. Contrasted so much different than the other three. And that there's no other competition for the source and for the answer and for the hope. It receives those seeds, and those seeds are able to root deep. And that's that fourth and final soil. So within the crowd, think about it. Jesus is not just randomly throwing up kind of an all-points bulletin. You realize he's speaking to the crowds that have gathered, that are huge, that he's in a boat because it's like a natural megaphone, okay, coming off his voice off that water so it hits the banks and everybody can hear. I'm probably thinking maybe 500, 1,000, 2,000 people on this beachside listening to this. You know that he's speaking with such passion. Why? Because eternity is a forever thing, that he is mentioning this because all four of those soils were in front of him. He knows that they're there. And he's trying to communicate this truth to say, hey, what soil are you? Think about you. Where are you in this parable, so that you might adjust your thinking and say, God, okay, how do I become more fertile? How do I produce more? How do I know you? And that's what he does. All four were present. His desire is that God would draw all of them to himself so that life forever would come to each of them. Next fill in the blank here. For the power of God to be realized within the individual hearer, it first must have a place that is your heart to receive the seed that is rooted deeply, because the heart is the hub. It's the hub for every human personality and by which all things are passed through. And so the truth is that only the heart that is fertile and belongs to God through faith, connected to Christ in relationship, those are the only hearts that are going to be able to be rooted deep. Now, such a heart here, the application I give you for today is this, another fill in the blank, is that a heart that responds to the message of Christ, that is his seeds being sown, will not ever become hard or shallow or choked out by the enemy or the world. So a heart that responds to the message of Christ, the whole reason he's came. He came why? Because man is incapable of saving ourselves. We cannot develop our own peace with God outside of the intervention of Jesus Christ on our behalf. And so he made that way the only way. That's why John 14:6 says, Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. And it's important to know that, because there's no end around. And you might try to go to God on your own terms, but guess what? In the end, you're going to be sad. You're going to be sad. And I don't want those words for any of you. Don't want that disappointment for any of you, or anyone that you know, or anyone that's in your life, or anyone that you frequent in terms of going to in town or the places you go to shop and things. No, God doesn't want that for anyone. But a heart that responds to the message of Christ, it will not ever become hard or shallow or choked out by the enemy or the world. I mean, what joy, what peace is there in that? That we can have that kind of stability, that we in Christ can be rooted deep, and that we can experience this only in Jesus. I mean, what a blessing that as each of us walk in confidence in this and security in this. Your next fill in the blank here. We must never forget or overlook the others around us as those who are in the crowd of Christ, who are hard or shallow in faith or being choked out, experiencing real life in Christ now and forever. Guys, I tell you, that's a thing. You know, We don't want to ever be indifferent to those who don't know him. We don't ever want to take that position that we're so comfortable and secure in our own self that, well, I hope they figure it out. I hope they get it. I hope someone talks to them. Right? I know it sounds heartless, but sometimes that's how we act, right? Don't take the time, don't make the time, don't want the time. See people and go, man, you're a hot mess. Holy cow, right? Right? And go, Jesus, you got somebody for that. That ain't me. That ain't me. Right? No. The truth is, guys, we're a hot mess. Anybody here a hot mess? I'm a hot mess. Yeah, I hate it. Only half the crowds are honest. The rest are lying. Right. That's awesome. We're all a mess. Everyone is. And we got to have that understanding and take that compassion. See, Jesus had compassion like that. And we need to have that same compassion. We need to never become indifferent to someone's spiritual state. Why? Because forever is a long time. Eternity is forever. And it's real. So we must never, ever, ever forget or overlook. See, the heart of Christ must be present in each of us. And what matters to him should matter to us. Amen? I mean, it needs to be that. That if it matters to him, then it matters to us. And you know what matters to him? The spiritually lost and those caught in darkness. God wants them found. God wants them free. He wants us free. He wants us to walk in the light. He wants all to walk in the light. So I'm going to challenge, therefore, each one of us, those in this room right now that claim Christ as Savior and Lord, you've made that profession of faith. He's in your heart. He's in your life. He's guiding you. He's your influence. If that's you and you're here today, I want you to begin to ask your Heavenly Father to reveal those hearts around you, those that are hard or shallow or choked out. And I'm not saying, hey, go up and say, dude, you're hard-hearted, you're shallow. You know, I'm not saying do that. That won't go well. That won't go well. I'm saying pray for them. I'm saying lift them up before the Heavenly Father. Ask God to do the work in their heart, in their life. And if you get privileged enough to be able to share truth with them, share Christ with them, then hallelujah. But if you're not the one, begin to pray that God would soften their heart. It would make it more receptive. There's a reason for that. It's huge, right? See, to love them, to serve them if you get an opportunity, right? To declare truth in Christ if they'll listen to you. You've heard the saying, right? And I'm sure some people have been really tough in the way that you've talked with them and they're like adamant about this or pushing you away or whatever. But you've heard the statement, right, that says you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it what? Can't make it drink. But I'm adding something to the end of that. I said, but you know what? You can always throw salt in the oats. Think about that. See, some of you are getting it now. You're with me. Might be able to lead a horse to water, but can't make him drink, but you can always throw salt in the oats. And see, salt in the oats is those kind words, those loving ways, serving them, loving them, being there in some moments that when their world's falling apart and you're able to say, you know what, hey, you know God's got an answer for that. He does. Let me tell you about it. Being able to share truth, you know, see, that's important. That's huge. That's huge. Most importantly, live Christ in front of them. Live Christ in front of them to see it, to hear it, to understand it, and to be able to receive it. See, God's the only one who knows your heart truly. We get that, right? God's the only one who sees it. God's the only one who knows. So therefore, it's important that we all ask God to examine our own hearts, right? We want to make sure that we're doing what's necessary. In fact, we want to take some lessons from my dad, right? We want to make sure we're fertilizing the heart, that is, putting the nutrients that's in it, it's necessary. Hello, the Word of God, yes. We're going to talk about that more as we move in this series. But yeah, that and watering it as he waters and soaks, that waters, that's the Holy Spirit of God moving in us and through us, right? Being sensitive to that. We want to ask God to tenderize our own heart, asking God to help us, that he'll reveal how open that we are to receive the truth and to give the only place able for that seed to grow that's in our heart. We need to make sure, God, keep my heart pliable, right? Isn't it David that prayed that prayer, said, search me, O God, try my heart, try my anxious thoughts, see, look, examine me completely. See if what? There's any wicked way within me, Right? You just open yourself to God. Let him do the work in you. So maybe some of you here today, some of you here today are longing to get out of here. You're like, guy, please stop talking, would you? Please. Right? Maybe you're like, I got to go, you know. Okay. If that's you, if you're going, inside and you're feeling like you want to run, I want to challenge you. Think. Is God trying to say something to you? Is your heart just like that hard ground, that caliche? And if you're resistant right now, you don't understand that what's being shared with you in this moment is life-giving, not life-taking. And God wants you to know that. So if you're going, say, God, help me understand this, or whatever you got to do. Seriously. Maybe some of you at this moment, maybe this sounds way better than your current thoughts. I want to encourage you to take heed in this. Don't let it merely be a moment thing. We don't know what tomorrow brings. We have no idea. In fact, selfishly, I would love for Jesus to return. You know what I'm saying? So we can be done, right? I want to go to heaven. I'm ready to go to heaven. That's where I want to be. But take heed. Don't let this merely be a moment thing, because God wants you with him. And he wants you to experience life with him and a relationship with him. And maybe here today, and this is all good, it's all good, but it's just not the greatest of the slot in your heart. Maybe that's you. And then maybe there's a lot of really good other kind of truths and beliefs that kind of I want to add to all this. Well, if that kind of even kind of somewhat fills in the gaps in Christ alone. But I want to say, take warning. Jesus says very, very clearly, there's only one way you're getting to heaven. And you can do whatever you want on this earthly empire. But in the end, every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And it's important that we know him. As with Christ, so with us, anyone who has ears should listen and should understand. There's only one way to experience the power of God at work within your life, within your heart, that is, that's open to him, because it needs to be fertile to be able to receive his message, to grow in his heart and cares, and to respond through faith, and to be rooted deep within him. And I'm so thankful, and I praise God for Philippians 2:13. And I'm going to end on this verse, and it says this, "For it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose." Isn't that awesome? That we don't have to do this in our own strength, in our own smarts, but we can say, God, I can't do this. I need you to do this in me. And you know what? He smiles and he says, let's get busy. And he works in you. And how beautiful is that? Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for your word today. Thank you that it is life-giving. And Father, that you have just such wonderful truth. God, we give you the praise and the glory for this. We thank you for each and every aspect of this message. Father, I pray that if there are some here today who don't know you, God, who maybe know just about you, or maybe don't want to know you, I pray, Father, for their heart of hearts right now. I ask in Jesus' name that you would soften their heart, that, God, that your word would penetrate through, that, God, they would come to the place, as I did at 15, to know that that moment was so needed and necessary in my own life to respond in faith to you, to say, Jesus, I can't do this. I can't do life on my own. I need you in my life. Come into my life and be my Savior. Literally praying those exact words. Father, I pray you would put that in the heart of those today who need to come to faith in you. For each one of us here, God, who do know you, who have that heart that's fertile and open, God, may we have it fertilized, may we water it, may we tend to it, keep it weed-free, keep it healthy and clean. And Father, may you give us a heart of compassion for those around us, that God, that we might bear your light, as you've called us to do here at Community Alliance, to know Christ. That is to know you intimately, personally, through and through. And that, Father, that we end with to make you known into all the world. Use us as your light to bring about your truth, and that, God, that you and you alone would set people free, that they might experience eternal life because it's a forever thing. We love you and thank you. It's in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Hallelujah.
I hope you take that word with you today and really consider the heart that you have, the soil that you're allowing God to work in. It is our privilege each Sunday to present to the Lord our tithes and our offerings. And so our guys are prepared here for sharing that. And if you are not quite prepared yet or want to do it later or whatever, we always have our blessing box that's outside there in the Welcome Center that you can present that in as well. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for what you've given us, and we pray now that as we give back, that it might be an offering to you, a tithe to you, a blessing to others, as we as a church are better prepared to share the gospel to greater and greater circles. We commit it to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Roger Rose, and I'm here today to talk to you about the Philippines missions trip. Now, this is coming up at the last week of May and the first week of June. It's a two-week trip, and it's an awesome time. It's been 15 years since I've been going there, and this is sort of a celebration because this is the first time the island that we're going to. I went to this island my very first trip 15 years ago, and it was so exciting. I can remember it today. And when you go on these mission trips, it's a lifetime memory. You'll never forget it. It's what a blessing. And we're here to offer this to you today, and we'll be announcing it in the next couple of months. Again, it's the last week of May, first week of June. There'll be a flyer out on the Welcome Center that you can pick up, and it looks like this. No, wait a minute. It looks like this. Okay? So make sure. Check that out. Take it home. Read about it. General things. What we do is we have medical, but you don't have to know anything about anything on medical. We just want you to be a part of everything that we're doing. And mission trip to the Philippines, last week of May, first week of June. And I'd love for at least 50 people to come. That'd be awesome. All right, I'll see you later. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Roger should probably stand and take a bow for this commercial there today. There is the forms or the flyers are back there on the Welcome Center table, and also there is a book back there of pictures of previous trips. And interestingly, Roger was showing me a picture of I think it was the first one, right, of you in it. And I can't even recognize him. He's changed so much in 15 years. He was 100 pounds lighter is what he's saying. Okay. Way back there. So anyway, that's an exciting trip and a very special time. And this is not near where the volcano is going off today, near Manila. So talk to Roger afterwards if you'd like to learn a little bit more about that trip. Also, wanted to just share with you briefly that we got a recognition from the Wickenburg Chamber of Commerce for the 35th anniversary. They sent us a plaque. So Phoenix Serve is coming up on the 26th, if you want to put that in your calendar ahead of time. And I believe that is all of the specific plans we have. Betty's waving a bottle at me. She's waving a baby bottle at me, which means that out there on the counter there is a box of baby bottles. This is our fill it up with, what do they call it, change or something, I don't know. Anyway, there is baby bottles back there. The idea is to take one with you over the next, a month? How much time? How many weeks do we give them? Something like that. Put your change, spare change in that and bring those back on a given Sunday or over whenever you get them full or sooner. Then we will pass along the funds to the Crisis Pregnancy Center that operates near us, okay? All right, so if that is it, we will be dismissed with a prayer. Thank you. Let's pray. Lord, we ask that your blessing be upon us as we go. Lord, as that song has reminded us with the offering, you have the forgiveness, that great grace that you give us, Lord. And even though we may not have been the best of soils coming to this point, Lord, today I pray that everyone would leave here with the intention, with the desire to be that fertile soil, that good soil that would receive the word implanted. We commit them all to you until we meet again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Have you ever seen the wonder in the glimmer of first sight? As the eyes begin to open and the blindness meets the light. If you have soul, say, I see the world in light. I see the world in wonder. I see the world in life, bursting and living.
Have you ever seen?